juicy diseases. And this is really centered around what Dr. Egan Russo coined in 2003 was the term clinical endocannabinoid deficiency. And up until this point, nobody even thought about the fact that every single human has endocannabinoids. We make anandamide, we make 2-AG, we make other endocannabinoids too. But nobody really thought to care about these levels, right? Is it important whether they're high, whether they're low? Do they affect health? Nobody cares, right? Because marijuana is illegal. Why would we care about the endocannabinoid system? But he started, you know, actually doing the research and came up with a theory that still today definitely needs to be, you know, be validated in several ways. But this is the key part, right? Whenever you have an imbalance in your brain and body, it usually leads to disease. And so dopamine deficiency, and dopamine is a neurotransmitter that controls movement, motivation, power level thinking, a lot of different things. But it, basically, when you don't have enough dopamine, it results in Parkinson's disease. When you don't have enough serotonin, which is a neurotransmitter that regulates a lot of things, including mood and learning memory, if you don't have enough serotonin, you have depression. We actually prescribe antidepressants to raise your serotonin levels and treat depression. Acetylcholine deficiency. Now, this is also something that's been linked to Alzheimer's disease, which is the disease of basically old age, in certain groups where they start, you know, losing all their memory and their ability to function day to day. So we have all these diseases that we know are, in fact, are due to neurotransmitter deficiency. So clearly, if we have cannabinoid deficiency, we should see disease. And in fact, because it's so important, again, this endocannabinoid system regulates every other system in your brain and body. So if that's off, goodness knows what would be off, right? So that's really the theory of clinical endocannabinoid deficiency, is that you don't make enough of these neurotransmitters, you have some other alteration of the system, whether it's congenital, meaning you were born with this problem, or you acquired it later in life, which means, you know, whether something traumatic happened to you or your diet or something you're doing is causing this cannabinoid deficiency. This is a real medical issue, and it's something that we should be exploring. And in fact, explain why so many cannabis users are self-medicating, right? Because they feel better with cannabis because they're offsetting a cannabinoid deficiency. So could you be deficient in cannabinoids? Possibly. One way that you might be deficient is if you don't make enough of these endocannabinoids. Again, if you're not producing enough anandamide, maybe your brain, you know, isn't producing enough because you have a gene mutation for it, right? And we're actually finding out that there's lots of gene mutations associated with changes in the endocannabinoid system and its function. And we'll be able to soon be able to use genetic testing to figure out how your endocannabinoid system is doing. Another way that you can be deficient in endocannabinoid system function is if you don't make enough of the cannabinoid receptors. Again, if you have a mutation in the receptor, then you're not going to be able to be receptive to cannabis because the receptors just aren't there on the cells. That also happens sometimes in states like cancer, right, where the cells are so different and transformed that they don't even express cannabinoid receptors anymore. Another way you can be deficient is if you have too many of the enzymes that break down. Endocannabinoids is a very complicated system that's tightly regulated, and if just one little thing is off, you can, you know, offset the whole system. Another way that you can be deficient is if you make enough of receptors, you make enough of endocannabinoids, but basically something downstream in the cell, like the pathways that happen when you turn on the receptors, is broken, then you're still going to have a major meltdown in your endocannabinoid system. So there's a lot of things that can go wrong. Clearly, probably is going wrong in the human population. So one of the things that we're really interested in is how can we test for the endocannabinoids? How can we find out if you're deficient, right? And this should be really simple and straightforward. Vitamin D, right? You can go to your doctor, you can order a blood test, you can even go online, like go to Life Extension, order a vitamin D blood test for yourself and find out, do I make enough vitamin D? Oh, I don't. Maybe I should get some pills. Maybe I should go, you know, to the tanning salon. Why can't we answer this question with our own endocannabinoid system? Why can't we ask our doctor for an anandamide blood test? And again, anandamide is the most common endocannabinoid. We should be able to figure out what is the health status of that system, especially when it's associated with very, like, a wide range of diseases. So Again, this blood test too could help validate the entire cannabis industry and mainstream it into health, because you can order this blood test, then the health insurance will say, well, this person has low levels of anandamide, clearly they need something that'll boost it, whether it's CBD, whether it's cannabis, whatever it is, right? We might actually be able to get coverage for the cannabis doctor visits and cannabis products. Problem is, this commercial blood test doesn't exist yet, and it's basically only available in a few academic labs. We're hoping to convince some bigger labs to actually start making this so that we can, one, do clinical research with anandamide tests, as well as start getting this to patients, because if your doctor doesn't care, well, you should have the right to order the test yourself and figure out what your cannabinoid status is. So there's several diseases that are associated with cannabinoid deficiency, and later on today we have a patient panel where patients with some of these disorders will actually be talking about how they use cannabis to help themselves. So you can talk to them a little bit after of the event too, to just, you know, get a little one-on-one and connect with fellow patients. But migraine is typically characterized by throbbing. It's, you know, like the worst headache ever. You can be nauseous, you have disturbed vision. Some people are so disabled they have to go to the hospital, or, you know, stay home from work. Some patients have what's called silent migraines, where they don't get the pain, but they have the nausea, like flashing lights, all sorts of just not great things for being able to operate in society. So migraines are actually a really common disorder. 23 million patients in the United States have that. So the fact that it may be rooted in endocannabinoid deficiency is a great new target for treating this disease. And how cannabis can help this, we actually know that THC can inhibit the amount of serotonin that's released from the blood cells, specifically called platelets, in your brain, and this mediates migraines. So if you can inhibit the serotonin release, you have relief from your migraines. Also, we know that endocannabinoids can inhibit certain subtypes of these cannabinoid receptors. So raising levels of your own endocannabinoids through taking CBD or through taking THC or through other means can actually help mediate that migraine response or possibly even prevent it. THC and CBD also both reduce inflammation and pain throughout the body. And of course, this would also hold over to fibromyalgia. That's another big one. That is covered by endocannabinoid deficiency. So this is a very complex disorder. It's actually one that I suffer from. That is characterized by widespread muscle pain. There's tender points. Like if you touch a person, they're not supposed to feel pain. I mean, most people with fibromyalgia will feel pain in certain spots. And they seem to be, they're not always the same in each patient, but there are general spots that are characterized by this disorder. And there's also like basically crushing fatigue, you have sleep problems, insomnia, you have memory issues, fiber fog is a big fun one. You have mood issues, because you know what, when you suffer from a chronic illness, obviously life is not easy, so a lot of patients can be depressed about their syndrome or just about their lack of sometimes ability to go to work. So some of these symptoms can be triggered from an injury, can be triggered from a traumatic event, surgery, stress, and we know that stress and the endocannabinoid system are tightly linked. So it's a very complex disease that doctors really don't know how to diagnose. Sometimes patients end up taking years sometimes to get diagnosed, or they're misdiagnosed with it. But it would be nice to be able to do a blood test, right, and show, hey, you don't have enough anandamide. Maybe this is the biomarker for fibromyalgia. So we do know that there's 5 million patients in the United States that have this disease, and cannabis can help by reducing pain and inflammation, it can improve mood, it can improve serotonin deficiency, which is one of the things that can lead to fibromyalgia. There's more and more clinical research coming out showing that fibromyalgia patients are using cannabis, and many of the ones that are actually sidestepping some of these other prescription cocktails that they're on. Patients are prescribed things from Lyrica. It makes patients gain 50 pounds, to antidepressants, to morphine, to a whole bunch of things. I mean, it's really a misunderstood disorder, and it'd just be nice if one thing could treat it, right? Let's see. So cannabis is also really important for a bunch of disorders of the gut, and one of the ones that's most tightly associated with endocannabinoid deficiency is called irritable bowel syndrome, or IBS. If you have a rumbly tummy, this is probably you. It basically affects the large intestine, and symptoms include cramping, abdominal pain, bloating, gas, diarrhea, constipation. Not all patients have all these symptoms. Some have one and the other. Some have alternating symptoms. It's just not a lot of fun. A lot of patients, a lot of people in the United States actually have this. Not all of them even know that they have this. Because they're on such a bad diet, they probably have these symptoms anyway, right? 25 to 45 million patients in the U.S. have this, and it's 10 to 15% of the population. It's sort of crazy, right? Maybe you go home and Google the symptoms and you're like, do I have this? But 2 in 3 patients with IBS are female, and the real kicker here is it impacts patients of all ages. So when we talk about cannabis, you know, it should only be available to adults, or when you have children with this disorder that might actually benefit. I believe that there's clinical research now going on, possibly here in Colorado and other places, with this disorder, and also pediatric gut problems. So cannabis can help IBS through a number of ways, but it can reduce inflammation because you have cannabinoid receptors in the gut, right? You also have serotonin receptors. You have a whole bunch of things. So if cannabis or THC or CBD treatment can basically activate those receptors. You're going to promote health in the gut, which is then the gut's really interesting too, because it also, you know, communicates with your brain. So if you have a healthy gut, you have a healthy brain, and a lot of disorders are linked to gut-brain issues, right? So if we can basically restore health to the gut, we can help, you know, activate. Also, I want to mention this So I didn't talk about these, the TRPV receptors, but there's basically an atypical cannabinoid receptor that's found in the gut, and it actually can reduce pain. And we know that your endogenous cannabinoids like anandamide or even CBD can actually activate these receptors, and so that's one of the reasons why it really helps with different gut issues, including irritable bowel syndrome. So here we have something that impacts so many people, right? These are really broad diseases. We have migraine, which impacts everyone, and probably anyone that's had a headache could probably benefit from cannabis. We have IBS. So, I mean, we have these diseases that aren't, you know, qualifying conditions in most states, right? But most of us deal with this. So pretty much cannabis could benefit mostly anyone in this room, right? When we think about it in its broad terms like migraine and gut problems or pain. So cannabis and the endocannabinoid system is really, really important. And I'm just going to talk to you a little bit about how we make a lifestyle change. So most people think that they can just pick up a joint and, you know, a novel user might be like, oh, well, that'll cure my cancer, it'll fix all my problems, you know, whatever my illness is. There's many ways to keep cannabis, there's many strains. You have to play around a little bit about what works for you. You're just not going to be able to go in overnight and change everything. So I actually talk about using cannabis for the novel patient as sort of a lifestyle change. You have to put more thought into it than you do for, you know, losing 50 pounds or 15 pounds, right? It has to be supported by positive lifestyle changes, a diet, all the other things that you think of whenever you make a life change. And going off of prescription pills, for example, to cannabis is a major life change. So the first step is really elimination or detox, right? You want to get out these things that are harming your brain, harming your liver, and harming your endocannabinoid system. So whether they're foods, whether they're medications, lifestyle factors that are harming your endocannabinoid system. After you basically get all the bad stuff out, then we got to put in the good stuff. And that's primary receptors. So basically when you add good and healthy foods, when you add the building blocks of your endocannabinoids, which can be found in things like hemp, when you have healthy lifestyle factors, you're basically setting your endocannabinoid system to work properly and be able to accept cannabis. The third step is stress management. So stress management is a huge, huge part of being responsive to cannabis treatment, whether you're chronically ill or well. Basically, your stress, your whole system that releases stress hormones and changes basically gene transcription is linked to your endocannabinoid system. So if you release stress hormones, you're going to make your cannabinoid receptors, they're not going to be be translated. They're not going to be produced. You're not going to have cannabinoid receptors on your cells. So if you're stressed out, there's no cannabinoid receptors, and your cannabis is not going to work as great. So the first thing you really need to do is breathe, right? So if we can manage stress by meditation, by exercise, by good sleep hygiene, most of us are not getting enough sleep. We're getting 6 hours of sleep at best. That can promote release of the stress hormone, which then is going to make a poor response to cannabinoid treatment, especially if you're ill. So getting a handle on stress can really help make sure that the medicine you're using is going to work. So after really this period where you get your life in check, then you can start adding cannabis in, whether, with the care of a doctor, a caregiver, health coach, etc. Figure out what the appropriate cannabinoid products are, adjust them based on your genetic factors. Again, we all have different genes for cannabinoids and different mutations in them. We all have different, ranges of health. We all have different lifestyles. Some of us, don't work from home. Some of us are athletes. We all have different backgrounds that might contribute to what's the best cannabis product for us. And also, depending on your location, right? You can't ship cannabis products over state lines. So, the best product for you may not be in your state. So either you may have to move, or you may just have to deal with what's here. And budget too. A lot of times, if you're very sick, a higher dosage of products might be recommended, but if you can't afford it, I would suggest that you reach out to dispensaries, caregivers, et cetera, people that can help you, or try to find a way to be able to take that medicine in a cheaper form, or just a more bioavailable form. So my book is coming out in June. 5% of sales go directly to Impact Network. You can pre-order it on theimpactnetwork.org. And speaking of books, we have our next speaker. Wait, I have to ask questions. I totally forgot that. Yeah, here we go. So you had a question, so let's start there.
So I was listening to the Holistic Cannabis Summit this week, and they were saying that the endocannabinoid system regulates the endocrine system.
Mm-hmm.
And so they've known this for 20 years. Why are doctors not being trained on this?
Again, it's hard to add things into the curriculum. We should be teaching this, right? And again, I think the statistic right now is that only 12% of medical schools even mention the endocannabinoid system, which is just bizarre in the first place. And we don't even know the depth of that message. Is it just they say it in one sentence, it's over? It might be that. There's no one actually, really going in depth. There's not endocannabinoid system electives. There's no residencies for doctors in cannabinoid medicine or anything like that. So it's very much like left open to, if you want to learn about the endocannabinoid system, you have to go to a conference or go to a workshop where they're offering continuing medical education. I mean, in fact, there's doctors here in Colorado that do that. Colorado Cannabis Clinicians offer a CME for that purpose. But it's just ridiculous. Yes, it covers so many different biological functions. You can't live without your endocannabinoid system. So it's ridiculous that it is not taught, regardless of whether or not cannabis is a Schedule I drug. We're taught more and I can say this, I didn't go to medical school, but in graduate school, when I was doing my PhD, they taught us more about cocaine, methamphetamine than they did cannabis. I mean, it really was like the smallest paragraph in there. So we could be doing a better job of training everyone. So it's ludicrous. Yep.
You mentioned the very high instance of irritable bowel syndrome, migraines, and all of these things that could be treated with cannabis.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess I just wanted to hear your thoughts on the fact that I think a lot of people have these, but they don't consider it a disease because mm-hmm. diseases are bad. Sure, I get headaches, I'm stressed, I have a stomach ache and I don't sleep, but I'm not sick, life just sucks.
Mm-hmm.
And how do you think we change the culture?
Yeah, so I think what you're really hitting on is that most Americans are sick and they don't even realize that they're sick, right? Our diets are bad, we're stressed out, we're not getting enough sleep, and maybe these factors are all cumulative and really causing harm to our endocannabinoid system. So if you basically get a blood test in everyone in this room, I would bet you that we're Well, not this room. Let's say we're in our non-cannabis users, right? But hopefully we're all not deficient here, right? But again, there may be new patients here. But I would say that, you know, in a state where cannabis is not accessible, not legal, you're going to have lower cannabinoid level, you know, endocannabinoid levels than you do in a legal state, and that would be a fascinating study to do. But the fact is that if all of us are deficient in this, right, then we all need cannabis, and we need cannabinoids in our diet, right? And, you know, that should be the argument of making it legal, like, we're all deficient in this. And in fact, the government's lied to us about a whole bunch of different things that they've known for a while. Vitamin D, for example, again, to bring it back there, they knew that people were deficient in vitamin D, but they were still recommending that we only take so little vitamin D, not enough to really raise all of our levels, and it turns out like 90% of us are deficient in vitamin D. We're not going outside in the sun, we're not, you know, eating the right things. But vitamin D is linked to tons of physiological processes, can be linked to depression, can be linked to cancer. So they even had a recent study showing that higher vitamin D blood levels are associated with reduced cancer risk. So vitamin D is available as an OTC, like dietary supplement, right? So if we could prevent cancer by taking vitamin D, why are they not telling us to go do that? They've been so, you know, hush-hush about it, but, you know, this is, you know, cannabinoids are just a list of long things that they've sort of been denying, sort of been hiding and not recommending. But honestly, if you want to improve the overall health of your citizens, you want to reduce healthcare costs, add a little cannabinoid, you know, medicine into their lives. I'm pretty sure that most of us have an issue and we would feel better. You know, it's sort of like when you go through a cleanse, right? You're like, I want to drink some green juice for 3 days. And you're like, wow, I didn't realize how shitty I felt, you know, before I did this, right? Maybe I should get up out of the cookies. In the same way, I think that a lot of people wouldn't realize how much cannabis or CBD or whatever product is might benefit them until they try it, right? But there's just that big fear, oh, I'm not a pothead, I won't try this, you know?
Good people don't
smoke weed. That was a lovely point there. Our senators actually had a hearing where they stated that, which is just atrocious. We have, you know, the prohibitionists out there trying to continue the stigma, right? There's actually a lot of associations trying to break that stigma, but we don't need that. We don't need people scared to talk to their doctors about cannabis because there's already judgment. You know, pretty much many of us could benefit. And I think that even if you're not ready for cannabis or you live in a state where it's not legal, you can prepare your cannabinoid system by so many different ways. You can buy hemp seeds, which provide the building block for anandamide. Again, you can de-stress. You know, just try to boost in whatever way you can. And there's also, I mean, CBD products can be shipped, you know, pretty much nationwide. Just find a good provider. If you don't know, ask them. So, more questions? Hey.
So, what do we really mean when we say something like that? It's not good enough for me just to say it's look at your mind, because that's just defined with another term I don't really understand. Mm-hmm. What from a neuroscience point of view, what does it mean for something to be psychoactive?
So it really means like changing your mindset, your mood. It's like a sloppy term. I don't really like it because CBD can actually be psychoactive too at higher doses, right? If you're taking 1,000 milligrams of CBD and you're a novice user, you're going to feel the effects. CBD can also inhibit liver enzymes that, you know, impact how your other medications are taken. So you can actually feel high from, say, an epilepsy drug you're on if you're not used to CBD, right? So this psychoactive term is just—it's sort of a stigma word, honestly. It really says, you know, who are you to decide, you know, how your medication changes your brain or your outlook? What does psychoactive mean, right? At 1 milligrams, cannabis or THC is really psychoactive. You could take 1 milligrams of cannabis as a pill, for example, and feel the same psychoactivity of a normal anti-anxiety drug. So it won't get you high, it will just get you relaxed. So what the difference between relaxation and inebriation, we have all these little terms. I mean, this is up for your doctor to decide how psychoactive your medicine should be, right? Not the government. I hate the whole terminology behind it, so. But you create a great point when we talk about lobbying in these different states, right? The biggest thing that they always try to push back and say, this is why it shouldn't be legal in this state. It's psychoactive. God forbid we allow somebody to have a head change, you know? And sometimes people are taking cannabis because they're depressed, because they're in chronic pain. If it relieves your symptoms and you feel good, you know, what's the harm? That's my personal opinion on it. psychoactive is just sort of just the you know, that terminology DEA tries to use on us to make us feel bad about the medicine. So.
Can you just talk maybe just a little bit about what the purpose of the endocannabinoid system is? Why do we even have one? Why is this sitting? Why is it important?
Yeah, so I mean, the endocannabinoid system is really regulating every other system in your body. Again, it's regulating how your cells talk to each other. So it really puts the brake on a lot of different neurotransmitter systems. But the whole point of cannabis is to really provide, the whole point of the endocannabinoid system is to provide balance or homeostasis. So when one thing is out of whack, basically your cannabinoid system will help, you know, bring it back down. If something is too little, it'll, you know, fine tune it right there. So basically what the most amazing part of the endocannabinoid system is, and why it works so well, like cannabis is good for treating so many different conditions, is because the cannabinoid system is on every cell. It's in all over your body. So when you take a product that activates your cannabinoid system, I mean, you can sort of, and not all of your body is out of whack, right? It's usually only one brain location or one part of your body. So cannabinoid products can really go into that specific region and fine tune. It's not gonna, you know, change what's happening in your leg and then ramp up everything everywhere else. That's not how it works. It's very, can act very locally or can act, you know, like in a very fine-tuned manner. Whereas most drugs on the market, right, if you take an antidepressant, that serotonin boost you get in the brain will also affect every serotonin receptor you have in your body. It'll affect the ones in your gut and give you diarrhea. You end up with all these horrible side effects. Cannabis, we don't really see side effects because it's really not working in that way. It really just works to activate and rebalance whatever's wrong in your system as opposed to every single cell with that receptor. So it's a very interesting, you know, pharmaceutical target. It's one that they don't understand, but it's one that's great for reducing harm from drugs. So.
You mentioned earlier too that terpenes are obviously found in other plants and everything like that. Mm-hmm. You also touched on that even cannabinoids are found in other places, because we're talking about the endocannabinoid system, mm-hmm. and it's something that balances out all the other systems apparently mm-hmm. in our body. Then is there other things that we get besides cannabis, more or less, you know, other cannabinoids that are actually acting on our endocannabinoid system, or is cannabis the main thing that actually, like, what's affecting our endocannabinoid system the most?
Yeah.
Is it cannabis, or is there other things that affect it?
Okay, so when we talk about dietary cannabinoids, we do consume, you know, on our best days, like 200 milligrams of dietary cannabinoids, but some of these aren't as potent, right? We're talking about the cannabinoid from black pepper, beta-carophyllene. That tends to work on CB2 receptors, which have a very different effect on CB1 receptors, and, you know, the dosage is not enough, usually. Again, sprinkling some pepper on your food is not going to, you know, relieve your pain, it's not going to cure your cancer, so don't get any bright ideas there. cannabinoids are found in echinacea, they're found in garlic, they're found in oregano, they're found all over the place, but not in the dosages needed for medicinal health. Again, you know, great to think if you're sprinkling on some of these spices, you know, in your food, maybe you're supplementing your cannabis, you know, lifestyle, but probably not. It's just, they're just in there. But for real health, you really do have to take the dosages that meet, you know, the requirement for relieving symptoms, right? We don't know the dosages for some of these new terpenes. You know, we do know that they activate certain receptors. You know, what the dosage of, say, beta-carophyllene you need to relieve pain or help treat osteoporosis or menopause, we don't really know. You know, they're as big of a black box as some of these new cannabinoids that we've discovered. But that should be an exciting field because those components, right, you can get beta-carophyllene extracts from jojoba oil, I think it is, and some other different sources. This is a supplement that is legal. It's a grass, so I mean, it's allowed to be sold in the market. It's been a dietary supplement for years. You can just find different sources of it online. Just make sure you're not getting one that's supposed to be an essential oil for putting it topically and then eating it. That's no bueno. But there are dietary cannabinoids that you can buy. So that's sort of a fascinating new way that people in, you know, not legal states can.
So it sounds like in order to get like concentrated amounts of these cannabinoids, it would make sense for us to get it from cannabis.
Well, I would say that the best source, obviously, of cannabinoids is cannabis because it has the wide spectrum, right? When you're taking a black pepper extract, right, it's not going to have these wide range of cannabinoids. It doesn't have any THC, it doesn't have any CBD. So, I mean, if you're really trying to heal a disease, you need very high doses of certain cannabinoids to relieve seizures or to heal cancer. I mean, you're not going to get it with a black pepper extract you buy from Amazon. So
I'm surprised that it was actually eventually going to be reclassified as a cannabinoid and not terpene. So is that what it takes to be classified as a cannabinoid to be able to attach to a cannabinoid receptor?
You know, I don't think there's really been any language on that, but it's just very interesting because it is acting on directly on the cannabinoid receptor. So I mean, maybe that's something we talk about as researchers at the next meeting or, you know, kind of the language of it. I just feel like it's funny when we're talking about, oh, well, this terpene doesn't directly interact with cannabinoid receptors. We know it does. So why is it a terpene anymore? I mean, yes, it provides flavor, and maybe that's the reason why we've been calling it a terpene. I mean, obviously, there's chemical differences between cannabinoids and terpenes, but I feel like activating the cannabinoid system, you should be a cannabinoid.
Makes
sense. Yeah. But I guess we also don't want to classify that as because all the cannabinoids are Schedule 1. So.
There you go.
That would be the main reason. Any other questions? Hey, thank you so much. And now we're on to our next speaker. So we have the author of the Cannabis